الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم لمصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين.
For me to stand before you and share with you my humble and emotional experience of my journey towards becoming the follower of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. It is a great pleasure and honor to be on Ahlul Bayt TV, a very, very important channel, a voice for the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt across the globe. My name is Nuru Mohammed. I am born in a city called Kumasi in Ghana. Kumasi is the second capital after Accra, which is the capital. And as you know, Ghana is the second leading producer of gold in the world after the Republic of South Africa. So I'm from the region where the gold is found in Ghana. The city of Kumasi, or the region they call the region of Ashanti region. I was born there. But originally, I'm not from Kumasi, because Kumasi is a place for a tribe called Ashanti, which is one of the very strong and powerful clan and tribe in Africa. I'm from a town, a very small town called Kumaya Kintampo. That is where my father and mother came from. But they moved to Kumasi before I was born. So I was born and bred in Kumasi. And my father and mother, they are Sunni Sufis, Tariqatul Tijaniya. So my father, grandfathers, grandmom, entire family, they are of that tariqa. And my father, who is late now, of course, is a religious scholar of Tariqa Tijaniya, was a great imam of our community. He was very studious and known very well in the community. Even today, people, when they see me, they would start crying, especially when I visit Ghana. And I would ask them as to why they are crying. They would tell me, because you make us remember your dad. Because he's from the family of scholars. His father, yani my grandfather, was also a great scholar. So he followed suit. I lost my father when I was 3 months old. So I don't know the happiness of a father. Like to see a son relationship with a father. I don't know that much. I was raised mainly by ladies. I was the last born of my father before he left this world. Mom and dad have 4 children. First is a sister, Jamila, she's alive. Second is a brother, Mohammed Arab, he's also alive in Ghana. And third is Jalila, she's late. And I'm the 4th child. My dad, being a religious scholar, Ghana, we have this type of a culture among the Muslims, especially the religious scholars. Religious scholars don't only focus on the religious activities and work they have, because religious scholars, mostly they don't get paid in Ghana, especially the Sufis. Okay, people come hadiya here and there, but there's not something fixed. So my father used to go to work and come back. So he fell sick. That's what I was told by my grandmom and my mom and my brothers and sisters. So he came, he was lying on a couch in the room. And as a small infant, 3 months old baby, I was 3 months. So my mother placed me in a cradle down there. So my father fell on me. And that was the end of my father. He left this world. So when he left the world, we were four. I have aunties, grandmom, means the mom to my father, and my father was her last born. So I being the last born of my father, she loved me so much. So I said, okay, the sister that I follow, I come after her, should be taken by my mom. And then my first sister went to one of my aunties, and the second brother went to one auntie. And then I was taken by my grandmom, because she said, since your dad is my last born and you are his last born, so you are like your dad to me. So she looked after me in Ghana, sent me to school, sent me to madrasa. So I finished my primary, alhamdulillah, she looked after me. I didn't know my mom much because I was young. She looked after me, she gave me everything. My mom later eventually got married to a stepfather. So she was somewhere. Okay, I would go and visit her, but I did not have that strong relationship with my mom, because as a young boy, you were brought up by your grandmom. So the only person you knew was your grandmom. Father was not there, no father figure. Brothers were there, but they could not play the role that father could play when he was alive. So I didn't know much about him. I just saw his picture. So alhamdulillah, my grandmom, she loved me so much. In fact, I would say she spoiled me until I finished my junior secondary school. In my final year of the junior secondary school, she fell ill. So she was moved from Kumasi to Kintampo. Kintampo means our hometown. She was moved there. Because her children were there, my aunties were there, and some of the uncles were there. So she was moved there. I tried just to finish my junior secondary school, struggling. She would send me some money because I was not used to my mom. I would go, my mom would give me some sort of support, but still I lost her because she moved to Kintampo and I was very close to her. So every week, every holidays, I would go to Kintampo. Even sometimes during school days, I would just leave the school and go to Kintampo because I was missing her. So during that time, it was a very difficult time for me. I was very young, and I was just about to finish my junior secondary school. Food was difficult for me. I was not used to my mom, so I wouldn't go to my mom. I remember during that stage of junior secondary, I would go to school without a cent in my pocket. My grandmom would send me small money from Kintampo because she knew the way I was. Sometimes, to tell you the truth, you know, orange, people would eat orange and throw it. I would take it and clean and eat. That's how I used to live. And that time, because of my father's status in the community, so I had the opportunity to study Islam from a young age. Because my father said at least one of us should succeed him to become a religious scholar. The rest are not. All the sisters, the brothers, they just went. My brother is an engineer, mechanical engineer. My sister, they studied to just a small level and they got married and that's it. And my grandmother used to tell me, your father wants you to become a religious scholar. You have to succeed your dad. So I kept on studying Islam. So during the course of that time, I was approached by a school. It's a ladies' madrasa kind of thing, to go and teach them Quran. So I used to go there, I used to get something there. That was where I started this issue of lecturing and whatever. I started at that age of 13, 14 to lecture, but in a Sunni Sufi way. So this is how I survived until I finished that junior secondary school. By then, my grandmom was in Kintampo. She was very ill. Now, our result came, because after junior secondary, you write the final exams. So after the final exams, result would come out. Result came, I passed. High school. Now, high school, you needed money, and it's very expensive. School of my choice approached me, because before the examination, you will choose where you want to further your studies. They approached me, they sent letters to me. You admitted, come and pay the necessary dues, and then you begin with your studies. I went to my mom that time, because I finished my high school. I'm going for high school studies. She tried here and there, but she did not have that money. That capability was not there. So she asked me to go and see her brother, my uncle, who is late also now. So I went to him. He tried, he gave me something, but it wasn't enough. So I had to travel to Kintampo, where my grandmom is. Families were there. So she gave me something, because she had some money in the village. I came, I paid everything. But unfortunately, the school of my choice, when I went, the amount of money they needed was too much, so I couldn't afford. Now I had to go and study in a village, a remote area, far from Kumasi. Because I had no choice, and I wanted to further my studies to the next level. So I pulled out of that school, and I went to that village. Okay, village was easy, affordable, but it was a struggle, you know, it's not easy. Far, the school is in the middle of a bush, you know, it's a Roman Catholic school. I went, I paid the money, and it was a boarding school, so I was living there. My grandmom used to support me, and my mom used to send something, but it wasn't enough. So what I did, as young as I was, around 16, 17, yeah, 16, yeah. I took a job of farming, weeding, to weed, to cut the grasses, and then we used to get some money from there. And that was what I was using in addition to what my mom was giving me to pay for my school fees. And at the same time, you have to study. So it was a very difficult and challenging time. This 3 years program. My grandmom, she was trying to support me. That in that first year, before I could finish, she died. That was in my second term, not even the first term, because you have 3 terms in a year in Ghana. So second term, she died. I was at school. I got the message. I fell down because now I realized who is going to support me. I rushed to Kintampo for the funeral, came back, began with my studies. Sometimes I wouldn't eat in the morning until night. I would only eat at night. And that school, when I went, I became the first imam of the school because they were Muslims, they knew nothing. And I'm from the city, I studied, I could lead Salat and everything. So I brought all the Muslims together, even the third year student, the final year, the senior. So we were there, but I was struggling big time. Big. At one stage, I even decided to leave the school. But something told me, man, let me just carry on. What are you going to do home? You're young, you need to study. So my mom used to support me, but it wasn't that enough at all. Sometimes I wouldn't take breakfast. I will only keep myself water, 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 dinner. So now my grandmom died. Who's going to look after me? I told my mom, you have to try. So my mom tried, but the sister that I came after her, Jalila, she took over. She said, I will support you with my mom. So she was married. So the husband was doing well. So they were supporting me. But still, what they were giving me wasn't enough. I had to go and work after school hours. I have to beg for money sometimes. Just try to be able to finish my studies. That first year finished, we went to the second year. Still doing the same thing. Sometimes there will be no food, groceries will be finished. People were coming with big groceries to the school. You had nothing. Break time, you would hide in the class until they finish eating from dining room, and then you will go with them. School uniform, very old. You've been using it. In New Year, people are changing. You cannot change. You know, that's the life. Fine. I tried, and alhamdulillah, I was becoming first in my class since first year. I was the top student, no doubt. First year top, second year even top, with all the struggles. We didn't try in my level best. Sometimes even I would go to school late, although we were sleeping in this, we were in the same vicinity, because you would work, come very tired, your muscles, everything. But I would go late. At one stage, the headmaster got angry. But I told him, this is my situation. I'm just trying to survive and you need to help me. So he understood. Now we were about to register for the final examination. There was no money. I went back home to my mom. She said, I don't have it. My sister was very ill. She got sick that time. She was my hope, and she got sick. And immediately she died. So now, whilst I was in Kumasi, I told my mom I'm going to just deregister myself from the school because I don't see any hope. Who is going to support me? Nobody else. So I need to leave the school, come back, and just do my own things. Allah. I would come, I would teach Islam here and there. So people knew me in my community. So I said, I will come and carry on with that. There's no problem. Okay, my mom tried her level best, and she paid. Now we came sitting for the mock. I got sick, stomach ulcer that time because of hunger. No food. I used to keep myself like that. I used to sleep on my tummy just to keep going. And now it was time for mock examination before the final exams. And we started the exams. I started vomiting blood on the examination paper. I went out. I came back. I sat on the newspaper. On the examination paper, I started shivering. I couldn't write. So the school told me I need to go home because there's nothing they can do. Village. Fine. Packed my stuff. I had not a single cent penny with me. How I was going to go, I didn't know. Student, who are you going to ask? And from our school to town is a very far. It's a walk of more than 1 hour to 2 hours. I literally walk from the school to town. I knew a lady there. She used to help us. So I went and borrowed money from her. And the money she had, she said, this one can only take you to Kumasi, but from Kumasi to home, to your location, is an issue. I arrived in Kumasi. And I couldn't walk because I was very sick. Whoever I met to ask for help, nobody helped me. Literally, I walked and I arrived midnight at home. I was sick. I went to the government hospital. I got some medication. I didn't go back to school. They closed because mock time they closed. And then we came back. Then I went to write my final examination. Alhamdulillah, when I wrote my final examination, I was like the second best at the school. I got distinctions. I passed all the subjects, 9 subjects. So I finished my high school. Result came out. I passed. University entrance requirement. I got it. And my aim was to further my studies to the next level. But now, who was going to fund me? At the same time, I wanted to study Islam to the highest level because I was very much interested in that. But Islam, now you want to study in Ghana. Ghana, I've been doing a lot of studies. I did all my Arabic studies in Ghana, especially in the course of holidays when I was at high school. Now I need to go further. And the options you have is Saudi Arabia and no any other place. Because my brother, he could easily send me to Saudi Arabia. Because he's in charge of sending all the students in Saudi Arabia. So my mom approached him. He said, no problem. When the results are out, bring his results to me, and then we'll make sure we help him. He goes to Saudi and study. I was happy, very much happy, because Saudi is like, so to speak, the Qibla, the direction of all the Muslims. You speak to any Muslim, they will tell you they are not wrong because Quran was sent there. If they were wrong, Allah was not going to send Quran there. Makkah is there, Medina is there. What are you talking about? This is the general perception up until tomorrow of our people. Unless you insist trying to show them the way and the direction. Fine. I went to my brother. When the results were out, I told him I've passed and passed well. Now you have to do your action. He said, no problem. He took my certificate, some forms to be filled. Yep. I filled them. Meanwhile, we were busy with our organization, Muslim Youth Association for Guidance and Enlightenment. We used to travel to villages. To tell you the truth, we once went to a village where we met ladies, Muslims, but they never saw Quran in their life for a single day. And they were Muslims. They were introduced to Islam and they were left like that. So we showed them Quran. Some of them, Muslims, gave birth to children, but they don't know what is ghusl. we had to teach them. So we used to do that, and we had passion for doing that kind of tabligh work, alhamdulillah. So through that, we, here and there, now and then, used to get information about Iran, about Shia, about this and that. But you know, among the first country where Iran established Hausa immediately after the revolution of Iran is Ghana. That is why all those who became Shias in West Africa, I can safely see all of them became Shia through the Hausa in Ghana. Because Iran established it immediately after revolution. That's the first country. Very big Hausa. They sent a lot of qualified scholars from Qom to go and teach people. And what they used to do when they would come, they were no Shias, so they would announce it publicly at the central mosques where Juma Salat have been held. Whoever is interested is welcome. Come, we'll take you to Accra. You study about Shiism. You will learn about it. So some of our guys, not me, they decided to go to Accra to study. Not me now. So they went. One of my very close friends by the name Darul Hikmah is currently in Qom. He went. So you'd come back and give us information during holidays, weekends, because not that fast, 4-hour drive. Oh, is this, this year, that. Meanwhile, we were bombarding our teachers with a lot of questions in Kumasi. Our brothers with a lot of questions. Our families with a lot of, because Darul Hikmah now was exposing us to the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wasalam. But by then, I was not that inclined. Until one day, I was sent by one of my teachers with a letter to give it to one of the scholars in Kumasi, Ustaz Kamel. He's late now. So when I went to him with the letter, he looked at me. He asked me, do you have a high school certificate? I said, yes, I just finished. How old are you? I'm 16, around 17. Yeah. Are you interested in Islamic studies? I said, yes, of course, but that's my passion. I don't want to do anything. So okay, tomorrow, 9:30 a.m., come to the Kumasi Central Mosque. He did not tell me what was going to happen. He didn't tell me Iranians. If he had told me, maybe I would consult my family. They would have told me, Baba, don't go. So I was excited because he was like a big guy, big shot when it comes to Muslim scholars. So alhamdulillah, in the morning I went. Through the help of one of his students, Ustaz Ahmed Saeed, who is the current secretary of the ulamas in Kumasi, not knowing that they were Iranians who were coming to interview students from Accra. But they came all the way from Iran, Accra, and they are coming to Kumasi. There were three of them, with the Iranian cultural counselor in Ghana by then, Mohammed Khatami. They came. We were 36 in number for the interview. By then, I was in the Shia. I wasn't. Here and there, I knew about it. Here and there, convincing sometimes, not convincing sometimes, you see. Alhamdulillah, it was my turn. I entered for the interview. And during that time, I had already applied to further my studies at one of the universities in Ghana. And I even went and sat for entrance exams, waiting for the result to be out to get my admission and start. Then Iranians came. I went for interview. They asked me a couple of questions, you know, Iranians. Why do you want to go to study in Iran? I was interested in going because by then, you know, our people couldn't separate between Iran as a Shia country and any other country. You know, a Muslim, they are Muslim. Ayatollah is a Muslim. Case closed. People didn't know that much, like unlike today, these are Shias. And you can become Shia. If people knew, they were not even going to be given the opportunity to enter the mosque. So, they interviewed me. Immediately after the interview, it took about 30 minutes. They asked me to recite Quran. I recited Quran. You know, Sunni is good with recitation of Quran. I recited, they were excited. So they gave me a letter to say tomorrow morning, early morning, you should be at our embassy in Accra. So after the interview, I realized that I wasn't alone. Out of 36, only six of us were given that green light. Let's meet in Accra. So early morning, everybody started gathering some money to go to Accra. 4 hours drive. I went home. I told my mom. People got excited. He's going to Iran. But they didn't know what was going to happen in Iran. They got excited. My mom just squeezed water out of stone, man, to get some money for me. I got the money. We went to Accra. Early morning, we arrived. These people were fast asleep. They were not awake. They were not up. We waited literally. They woke up later on, and then they conducted exams, qualitative and quantitative exams. Just objects, just to try your mentality and how you think, your psyche and philosophy. So after the exams, out of the six, they told us three passed, and I was one of the three. But they said, now you have to wait for us because we're going to Iran. You'll hear from us. So fine. We got excited. They gave us our money back for the transport and we went back home. Informed people. Now we're waiting. Today, tomorrow. Now you heard that you applied for admission. Yes, the Kuwait. Yes. So I said to myself, whichever way comes first, alhamdulillah, I will go because me, I want to study. So they gave us a phone number, Iranians, from Accra, to just follow up. I would call, they would say, no, not yet, my brother, not yet. Nothing has come from Iran. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, nothing. Ya Allah, what's going on? So meanwhile, somebody advised us with a tree. You guys, you may be going to Iran. You rather start reading about this, she asked. So we started reading some books here and there, but those books were not making sense to us. Salat that way, wudu this way. They were not making sense to us. So we would ask our teachers, they would tell us, no, there are only four mazhab. Maliki, Hanbali, Shafi, Hanafi, this Shia, no. So I remember one time I asked my teacher, why the Shias are not good? He said, because they curse Abu Bakr. They know the wilaya of Abu Bakr and the wilaya of Umar that every Sunni has. It's not a joke. So, after 3 months, we were called by that alim who advised me to go to the mosque because it's like their guy in Kumasi. They send names of those they admitted. Not only from Ghana, like from all across Africa, because when they came to Ghana, they went to other African countries to admit students. So I saw my name and the other two. Alhamdulillah. Kuwait is not here. But Kuwait guy was telling me, don't go to Iran. Because they knew, my brother knew, don't go. I kept on waiting. I said, no, I need to go and find out. So Iranians sent us tickets. The day the ticket came, they asked us to come to Accra for visas. I had no passport. I didn't know what passport was all about. And now who was going to help me with passport? I had no money. And I'm told the tickets are ready. I went to my mom because that was the only person I could go. My brother, I couldn't talk to him because it's not easy. So my mom said, look, I will send you to Nigeria. Because at that, my brother, who said, I said, mechanical engineer. This brother who is Wahhabi is not my biological brother, by the way. It's my cousin. But the Ghana, you said, brother. And it's like the main guy in our family. He's the main guy. He calls shots. If he talks, people say how high I jump. Because like an Islamic scholar, so everybody listen to him. So my mom said, let him send you to your brother in Nigeria. It's not far from Accra to Nigeria or Kumasi. It's a travel of a day or even half a day if you leave early morning, early dawn. Fine. I went. When I arrived in Nigeria, my brother wasn't in Nigeria. He went to Burkina Faso. Fortunately, his wife told him, look, your brother was here. She called him. So from Burkina, he did not go straight to Nigeria. He passed by. So he took me, he did a passport for me. Alhamdulillah. So then he gave me the passport and he left for Nigeria. That was what he gave me. And he left, alhamdulillah. He did his job. His job is done. Now I took the passport to the Iranian embassy. Okay? And the same day, there and there, because the visa already came, educational visa, they inserted and put the visa in my passport, and the three of us. Journey to Iran began. I did not even go back to Kumasi. Only spoke to my mom, and my mom told me, don't tell anyone, because if you tell any other family, they will not allow. She gave me $50 as a pocket money. We arrived in Qom. This is the beginning of my transformation. When we arrived in Qom, the school officials came to pick us up from the airport. And they took us a place, they called it Mehmon Sara in Farsi. Mehmon Sara means like Musafir Khane. It's a lodge, bread and breakfast kind of thing, where guests come, guest house. Well, at that moment, if I had a ticket, return ticket, I was going to go back to Ghana. Because I saw the place, this is a new place to us. What's going to happen here? The food they give us, bread and something, their own food. I cannot survive, man. I've never traveled like this. I was just crying that night. But finally, they were clever, Iranians. They called Ghanaians, who were students in Iran. They came just to talk to us in our local language, to console us. Alhamdulillah, they made us feel at home. We stayed there, we went for our medical checkups. They put us into Farsi. So that was where we started reading, but through the Ghanaian brothers. Because they will not ask you to read any, you'll just read the Farsi for the first 1 year. So we did the Farsi, but the Ghanaian brothers, they knew we were not, especially me. I wasn't a Shia. So they used to come, spend a lot of time with us. It was not working out. They will try. So these Ghanaian brothers, there is a brother, I thank him so much, brother Ahmed. Ahmed is now teaching in Ghana, the Hausa. He used to come and spend time with me. Spend time, literally. Sometimes the whole night, and he was a married person. Show me this, show me that. And by then I was still young. 17, going to 18. Read this, read that, read. But I knew Arabic. That was one good thing which our people, mashallah, they are doing very well. I could speak in Arabic fluently. I could talk to anyone in Arabic. So he would give you books in Arabic. So, but I was not into going for research or something. So Ahmed, he tried his level best. So he adopted a strategy. Beginning, he was very calm with us, especially with me. Very calm. Tried to show me, but then he became like aggressive. Very aggressive. In the sense that he would show me, you know, what you are doing is wrong. Wrong. So that strategy of his helped me a lot. Because I used to get angry and I would have nothing to produce of material to show him. He would show me verse of Quran, hadith, riwayat, and I had nothing. I would only talk. Then one day he came in the afternoon. He waked me up. See, even if you don't want to become a Shia, don't worry about that. But at least learn something. So that tomorrow when you go home and you ask, you are able to say something. This is a very interesting thing I'm going to mention now. I said, what do you mean? He said, no, you learn. Read what I'm saying. I'm not saying you should take from me. Read. Okay. I started reading like a mad person. I became a bookworm. I used to go to the library. I still have those books, where I used to take note of all that I was reading. I would go to the big books like Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslims, all the six books. If not all the books, most part of those books, I read them, especially those areas talking about Ahl al-Bayt. So I started getting convinced little by little, not that much. And at one stage, I would cry. And I was a young boy. My family now, they were worried. They were sending me letters, come back. Why you put yourself there? They were pressurizing my mom. The ladies' madrasa, I used to teach ladies' madrasa. That was the first teaching I was teaching. They were pressurizing my mom. Why you send your child there? This is wrong. So by then it was a letter, and a letter would take like a month or two to arrive in Ghana. So the first strategy I adopted, after going through those readings, it took me good 6 months to 1 year, not a joke, when I was now going to turn around 18 or something. I wrote letters, different letters. One brother was going to Ghana, I gave it to him. To my parents, to my teachers, especially who taught me in Ghana. And when you are coming back, because he was going for a week, please try to get me the response. I just wrote to them, look, I'm seeing something here, which like making sense to me, but I'm failing to take a decision. Is there anyone who can help me? They replied back, 3-4 of them. Simple reply. No, these are Shias. Don't worry yourself about it. Don't take anything. You study the important ones like Arabic grammar, Sarf, syntax. Just study and come back. But really, it started haunting me big time. One stage, I would sit alone and cry in the library. And you'll see my tears on the table and on the books. Because I was reading now, reading. Where they attack Fatima to Zahra. Where the leadership was used there from Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Battle of Ghadir. You know, Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, what happened. And I would read and I would refer it to the books and it will be there. In all the books of our Sunni brothers. Now, I reach a point that no, this is making sense. And the point which destroyed me completely is the question of Fatima al-Zahra, alayhi salatu wasalam. That she's the only surviving child of Prophet Muhammad. What happened to her? All other stuff did not really convince me, to tell you the truth, from the beginning. That point, Zahra alayhi salatu wasalam. If say I'm Imam today, that is how I used to ask myself. And I die, I leave this world. Will people go and think of burying me or not? They will go and think of who's going to succeed me. So I used to ask myself, but why it happened to Rasulullah? But that still never helped. You know what I did? This is my transformation. But still, that was not 100%. I decided to fast for 3 days in Qom at a school called Hujjatiya. And by then, I did not like start fully my religious studies. Here and there, because they were also making ihtiyat, you know, precaution. They know their story and they know their strategies. And you know, even the Pharisee madrasa, I fought to leave the place. I studied Pharisee only for 4 months. Then I realized I could speak well. I told them, no, me, I'm not interested. So 3 of us, they left us. We went to Ujjatiya. I fasted for 3 days alone. And my imam asked Allah, look, Allah, I'm confused. Born Sunni, brought up as a Sunni Sufi. I'm discovering something. I'm now 50-50. I don't know where to go. I used to cry. Every night I used to wake up, I used to pray to Allah. I used to beg Allah, literally. I used to cry the whole night until my roommate would wake up. One Indonesia boy, he would wake up. Now, Allah is great. On the third day of my fast, after I broke my fast, salat, everything. That night I dreamt Imam Ali in Kaaba. And he told me within a twinkle of an eye, you are looking for something and you are there. Wallahi al-Azim. In Qom, hujjatiya in our room. You are looking for something and you are the inkaba. So I woke up frightened. I got scared. I was just praying that Fajr will just arrive so I would be able to ask the Imam of the mosque, Sheikh Nuri. He's late now, very old Sheikh. People used to go to him for istikhara and consultations. Early morning, I went to him. And I narrated, I did not tell him about my transformation because he didn't know he's just Imam there. So he told everybody there is a Shia. I saw Imam Ali in my dream. And I'm told this Imam Ali. But he told me, look, you are looking for something, stay here. You found it. He asked me, no, you are looking for something and Allah is showing you.
Then he looked at me, wallahi, he told me the same thing Imam Ali. He said, look, are we looking for something? You found it, don't go anywhere. Stick to that thing. From there, I said, look, I'm not going to do anything. I need to go back home. I decided to go back to Ghana. Guess what happened? By the time I arrive in my city, the news has already spread I'm a Shia. And I wasn't a Shia.
From there, I got a little bit of satisfaction. But still, not decided to become a Shia. I said, okay, now it's making sense here and there. I'm climbing slowly. I need to go back home to Ghana. I don't want to do anything here. Because I was really confused. Okay, the fast, which I asked Allah to help me to show me the way, alhamdulillah. I saw Imam Ali still. So I requested for ticket. Alhamdulillah, they gave me. I went back home. But with return, they gave me return ticket. But my aim of going home was that I'm going to meet the top scholars in my city, including my brother. Ask them a few questions of what I've researched on. If they are able to answer me, I will not come back here. Because this place is confusing, place is confusing me. But if they are unable, nothing will stop me. I will come back, I will further my studies, and I will go back there and propagate Shiism. So I went. But how do you get to them? It wasn't easy. It was very difficult moment of my life. School time was nothing, zero, compared to what I faced when I came back from Iran. After 1.5 years or 1 year, friends left me. The school where I used to teach, I thought I would get asylum there. Arrived, everybody walk out.
You know, you miss your family, your father, your mom, your sisters. You entered, wallahi, the house, everybody left you alone, standing. I started crying. I was a young boy. I entered, even my mom wanted to greet me, but people were telling, Najis, wallahi al-azim. This is very serious, brothers and sisters. Hey, I was exhausted, I was tired, no food, no water, nothing. And everybody left me.
I was left alone. I would cry. I would sit alone and cry. Family, it was only mom. Nobody was ready to talk to me. I'm kind of najis. Food, no food. Place to sleep, very difficult. Sometimes you'll sleep on a corridor of a house, of a, you know, flat scent. Where to go, who to talk to, who to sit with. Mom making ihtiyat, everybody making precautions. And I'm the first Shia. Of course, there was some Shias who went to Iran, but they stay in Accra. In Kumasi, I'm the first with my friend to go to Iran. So it was a news in that community. It was a news in that community. So people, oh, now Nuri is a Shia. We cannot do anything with him. They were bombarding my mom. Okay, fine. I went to one alim in a village nearby my city. I used to teach when I was Sunni there in Atis Madrasa. And I requested from him, Sheikh Rufai. He's the imam of a town called Ejisu. It's a village. I spoke to him. I need your help to contact 4 ulamas in my city. So he agreed. He agreed. Went to the first alim. First alim was the one who sent me to that mosque for interview. When he saw me, he stood up. He hugged me. Nurul Yaqeen, because that's my full name. When did you come back? Just came a few days ago. I'm happy. That was his words. Before I could say anything, he told me, go back and study, close your ears. You will be the future leaders of this community. Allahu Akbar. Offered me tea, water, dates. So I said, Alhamdulillah, here, I'm not going to ask anything. I'm done here. Then we went to a second alim, very powerful scholar. He's even a dictionary of Arabic and Hausa, our language. He studied in Azhar. He's got a PhD from Azhar. Sheikh Hassan, big. He asked me a few questions before I could ask him. Why do you prostrate on Turba? Or how do they do that? Then I gave him a simple riwayah from Rasulullah. Ju'ilat liya al-ardu masjidan wa tahura. Allah made this earth for me masjid and a place of purification. So I told him the logic here is that. Why do you make sajida on earth, but you don't purify yourself? You know, why you purify yourself for it, but you don't make sajda on it? So you didn't understand what I was trying to say. So purification means tayammum. And sajda, salah. Ju'ilat liya al-ardu masjidan wa tahura. Allah placed this earth for me. A masjid, yani sajda. Kalla la tuti wasjud waqtarif. Salat is in sajda. And then tahura, to make tahara, means tayammum. Said, why if there is no water, you make them, but sajda you do on carpet? Then he himself said, Allahu Akbar. So he was telling that alim who took me there, look at the logic. Allahu Akbar. Then he asked me a second question, but why Milad and Nabi you do on the 17th? Because he was learned, he studied. I told him, yes. Even within Shias, we have few scholars who said it was on the 12th. But majority said it's on the 7th. So therefore what Iran did, they said on that 12th is a unity week. You meet as unity, and then 17, all Shias across the globe on that same day celebrate. Because Sunnis is not like that. They do Milad Nabi for 5, 6, 7 months. You do today, he does the next day. So he said, Allah, so if you come back, are you going to propagate Shiism? Then I told him, it will all depend on this trip. Once I'm convinced, it's fine. So he told me, mashallah, it's making sense, but try, don't cause fitna. I said, fine, I'm done here. I want him. So I went to the one who taught me, my mentor, the third one. When he saw me, he jumped, he held me. Oh, when did you come back? Alhamdulillah. He taught me Arabic. In fact, all Sunni studies, he taught me Sheikh Mohammed Thani. Then he started questioning me before I could question him. Because everybody was eager to talk to me. Shia this. So I started giving him a brief background of the question of Khilafah. Wallahi, he told me, keep quiet. He said, a few months ago, I was reading about this Khilafah, where Rasulullah said, give me pen and a paper to write something for you. Then the second Khalifa said, wa'in. Inna rajula la yahjura. The man is migrating. Yani Rasulullah. So I asked my teacher, then what is your take? He said, from there, I told some of the teachers from the school, don't blame somebody if he says Shia. So I asked him, then what is your take? He said, no, go and study. Don't worry. Fine, I won. The last one was my brother. That was my final. He brought a lot of people, some family members. They organized the meeting. We went. I was sitting down. It was a sign of respect. They were sitting. So my brother started. He said, no, Shia, they curse Sahaba, Shia. He said, no, we're not cursing Sahaba. What we do is to narrate what they did. If it's negative, then it shows something wrong. Fine. He said, no, they are Quran. I said, no, we don't have any Quran. This all myth. He talk. Then it became a little bit of debate between me and him. Then I asked him a question. I told him, if you respond this question properly, not you alone and all those sitting here, Alhamdulillah, I'll not go anywhere. I'll join you guys. But if you cannot, be rest assured, I will declare my Shiism. And if I die, I should be buried like a Shia. Nobody should claim my body except Shias. Everybody was sitting, family members, looking at me, opening their eyes. I asked him, my brother, you studied in Saudi Arabia for many years, more than 10 years, 15 years. You guys sitting here, all the students or ulama, you've been in Saudi either for Hajj or to study.
Is there any one of you who can tell me whether he has seen where Fatima al-Zahra is buried? And I told them, if you answer this question, I promise you, I will either go to Kuwait or Saudi to study. I'm done. Wallahi, they all kept quiet. I said, show me. Because me, I'm at this stage, I'm really boiling. I've seen the truth, but I'm scared. Then one of them said, you see, you talking this year, you, when you come, nobody will look after you. And he was angry talking to me. Nobody will give you a house to sleep. Like, look at the way you are suffering. Look at how dirty you are. I said, no, that doesn't matter. I just need to know. Any one of you can show me where Fatima is buried? Wallahi, they all kept quiet. Then I told him, can you borrow me your book, Tarikh al-Khulafa, for Ibn Qutayba? It's not our book, it's their book. And I know he has the book. After I insisted, he brought the book. You just go, Tarikh al-Khulafa, for Ibn Qutayba. First 2-3 pages, don't go far. I open for him. You know what does it say? Where the second Khalifa said, La uhurikanna aw la yukhrijanna. Kila inna Fatima binti Rasulullah. Kala wa in. He said, the second Khalifa said, they should either come out to pay allegiance to Abu Bakr or we will burn the house. Then one of his companions said, Fatima, the daughter of Rasul, is in the house. Then he said, even if she is in the house. My mom was crying.
So when you go to Muhtar Malik, Bab al-Jihad, on the day of the battle of Uhud, Rasulullah, after the battle, was witnessing to some companions. So he did not mention Abu Bakr and Umar. In Muhtar Malik, Bab al-Jihad. So Abu Bakr and Umar asked him, Alasna minhum ya Rasulullah? Aslamna kama aslamu wa amanna kama amanu. Are we not among them? Didn't we become Muslims like the way they became Muslims? Didn't we submit like the way they submitted? Rasulullah said, Bala, walakin la adri maza satuhadithuna ba'di. Yes, but I don't know what will happen after my death. I quoted it. I said, you can bring the book, I can show you. Then I said, link this with the verse of Quran. Afa immata aw kutila in kalabtum ala aqabikum. O man yankaliba ala akibai falen yadurru Allah shay'a wa sayajiz Allah shakirin. If you, Rasulullah, die a normal death, or your death is caused, they will go astray. And whoever goes astray, it will not harm Allah anything, and Allah will certainly reward those who are grateful. I told them, now I'm done. Inshallah, I'm going back to Iran. I'm going to study very hard and know that I'm a Shia from today. Alhamdulillah. Indeed. Words cannot do justice to the role that Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam played in my life. No matter how I will narrate and speak, I don't think I will be able to do justice to it. I don't think so. But I will highlight on the roles that Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam played in my life. Number one, which is the biggest one, through Ahlul Bayt, I'm able to transform myself from the darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge. I'm a proud Muslim. I can speak anywhere without fear of intimidation, and without fear that somebody will tell me you are lying or something of that sort. I know my story through the barakat and the blessings of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. They liberated me mentally and psychologically. I'm free wherever I go. And through this, I've been to many places. I met great Sunni scholars, had a lot of discussions with them. And this all through the ni'mah and the blessings of Ahlul Bayt. In fact, what I can say, Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam are my life. I cannot imagine me living without Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. I cannot think of a life without them. To me, wallahi, life is meaningless without Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. Therefore, my effort is for Allah to help me and give me the tawfiq to keep this love of Ahlul Bayt. It keeps me going during difficulties and during happiness. I learned how to forgive when I discovered Ahlul Bayt, because I knew what happened to me when I discovered them. I was denied food. I was denied shelter. I was denied water. For almost 3 months, I had no place to go. I had no place to sleep. But they kept me going. At one stage, I would say to myself, leave it. Why you are forcing yourself? But something else would tell me from the other side of my senses, keep going. So this is where they brought me as far, I can say. They took me from nothing and they made me somebody. My effort is to make others discover this school of thoughts. And alhamdulillah, through their ni'mah and blessings, so far, more than 500 people have discovered this school through this servant, humble servant of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, that is myself. So yeah, Ahlul Bayt, really I cannot do justice to the role they play in my life. It's everything. Today when I go back home in Kumasi, in Ghana, I'm highly respected. In my community, in my family, I'm welcomed very well. I'm giving high respect in my community. I'm giving platforms to speak and to give lectures. These are all through the Nuru and the Barakat of Ahlul Bayt, not from me. It's them who are doing it. So I owe it to them, really. Only what I plead with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep this love in my heart and to keep me going.